Hi there, and welcome to Bayside Christian Church. We're glad that you're here and hope that you're ready to encounter God's love as we share from the Word today. And if you're new to Bayside, a very special welcome to you. Be sure to click on the subscribe button and the notification bell so you can keep up to date with all of our videos and messages. And feel free to like, share, and comment. Hi there.
But when you went like that, I was perfect. Like, I'm literally, it's just going.
Everyone, how's everyone going? Great to see you today, church. Why don't you stand to your feet? It's so good to have you at Bayside. We're going to worship Jesus this morning and lift up his name because he's worthy of all the praise. We have the freedom to come and praise and worship him. So let's lift our voice. Let's focus all our attention on him today. No matter what's happened through the week, good or bad, we're going to focus our attention on him and lift up his name. And his presence is going to fill this place and touch every heart and life. We thank you, Jesus, that you would move in this place. Come on, lift your voice for a moment. We come to honor you and exalt you today, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You welcome Holy Spirit in this place. Let's go worship the King.
Come on, there's freedom in the house this morning. Come on, clap your hands.
Step out of the grave, break into the wild, and don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting.
Come on.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom. all of the scars. Come back to communion. Come back to the start. Oh, we're run, run into wide open spaces. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love.
Shake at the sound in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Lives made whole. Hearts awake at the sound in Jesus' name. Oh, chains will fall. Prison shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole. Hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. I praise when I'm doubting.
surrounded.
Thrones and dominions, all power.
nations, your name, it stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you were lifted up, holy, holy forever. And if you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, oh, sing the song forever to the Lamb. Come on, that's us. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, oh, sing this all forever to the Lamb. Oh, we're singing, sing this all forever and amen. And the angels cry.
Hey.
we wait on you, Holy Spirit. Let the key of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my soul. Let the key of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my soul. 'Cause you are good. You are good, you're good. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good. Oh, of my heart. Anchor in the waves, oh, he is my soul. King of my heart, be the fire inside my veins, the air. Oh, come on, let's sing that again. Oh, let the key of my heart be the wind inside my sails,
the anchor in the waves.
You're never gonna let me down.
You up, you're the King of Kings and you're the Lord of Lords. And Lord God, our desire is that you be the King of our heart. When we put you as King of our heart, Lord God, everything else falls into place, everything else finds its place, Lord. So today, maybe you're in this place and you're saying, you just want to declare from your heart, you say, Jesus, I just put you as Lord, I put you as King of Kings, King of my heart. I want you to lift your hands for a moment and just declare and begin to thank him. That he will lead you and he would guide you as King of your heart. King of your heart, because he is good. Because he is good. Because he wants good for you. He wants to lead you and he wants to guide you. So Jesus, we just lift you up today and we exalt your name above every other name. Thank you that you are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. That you want to be King of our heart. King of our heart, Lord God, as we sang this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We have quite a few prayer requests this morning and just want to list a few of them. We want to pray for people this morning and maybe others are here as well that you might have put in a card, but you might have family that are unwell or you've been unwell or with lots of flus and viruses and things going around. But a lady called Cara is just in hospital with breathing problems and asked for prayer. Also, Barry Child's having his first treatment on Tuesday and he's asked for prayer as well. And Pat, a friend of Anita in our church, is she's having some tests for cancer and she's scared and worried and has asked the church to pray for her. Also, Annette Locke has asked for prayer for her daughter, whose father-in-law passed away suddenly. And there's some others as well that have been unwell or sick with colds and flus. And so if you've been unwell, if you have a family member that's been unwell, why don't you just lift your hands in this place? Maybe it's been yourself, or maybe it's been your family or friend. And we're just going to begin to pray. Why don't you reach out your hand to someone nearby? Maybe you're battling some diagnosis or sickness of some kind. But we know that Jesus, that by His wounds we have been healed, and we declare healing in Jesus' name. Thank you, the blood of Jesus that was shed on Calvary for us, that makes us white as snow. By His wounds we have been healed, Lord God. And we agree together, we agree in this place together as the body of Jesus Christ, that Lord, that You bring healing to these people, Lord God, to all these people I've named, Father God. Pat, who is worried, Lord God, I pray that, Lord God, Your perfect love would drive out all fear, Lord God, in her life, that she would have Your trust and Your strength, Lord, right now, Lord God, that she would not worry or fear, Lord God, but You would strengthen her and comfort her. I pray for others here, Lord God. I come against cancer in Jesus' name, and I rebuke it in Jesus' name, and I cut it off in Jesus' name, and I speak the name that is greater than any cancer and any sickness, and I speak the name of Jesus, who is the King of Kings, who is the Lord of Lords, Lord, over Your people today, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for Your presence in this place. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord God. I pray for some people in this place that you're struggling with some fear and anxiety. It feels like a weight upon your chest. But Jesus is the King of all kings. He's the one that brings freedom and life. He breaks every chain. He brings freedom to every captive. And He doesn't want you to live with any anxiety or fear or depression. So if that's you today, right now, in Jesus' name, I speak to you. And I tell that thing to lift off your body right now. Whatever the cause of it is, I just pray you focus your attention right now on Jesus. He says, focus your attention on Me. And all those things that you worry about, all those things will become small in comparison to Him. So Lord, I pray for every person that may be you. You don't have to put up your hand, but you know it's you. But I pray for you right now. Lord, let's just, church, just pray for one moment. Lord, I pray, Lord, for everyone that's dealing with that right now. I just speak life and I speak freedom in Jesus' name. That every bit of darkness, every scheme of the enemy, any lie of the enemy, Lord, every untruth, every attack on their mind, Lord, I cut it off right now in Jesus' name, and I speak life to flow in this place right now in Jesus' name. I speak freedom in Jesus' name. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. You desire freedom. Like that first song we sang, we just freedom. We spoke freedom, freedom, and I speak freedom into your life in Jesus' mighty name. Let's just give Him a shout of praise, church. Come on. Let's give Him a real shout of praise. He's worthy. He's worthy. Thank You, Jesus. You're worthy of all the honor and praise today. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Awesome. So good to have you in church today, and welcome if you're visiting or here for the first time or recently moved to town or someone's dragged you along, whatever we got there. Great to have you here. And if you didn't get a welcome pack on the way in, you can grab one on the way out. Just ask one of the team. And afterwards, we have tea and coffee outside, and grab a biscuit, hang out. We'd love to meet you. There's a welcome area out there. But why don't you turn around, say hi to someone nearby, front or behind, someone you may know or not know. Awesome. So good to have you here today. You should come back and find your seat. And it's great to have you at Bayside, and encourage you to stay after the service and catch up with some more people and meet some new people and make everyone welcome. One thing we love to do at church is to come around communion and focus on what Jesus did for us. And we take that of great importance. So today I'm going to welcome Pastor Mary Lynn as she comes and shares. Let's welcome her. She comes today.
Thank you, Pastor Pete. How are you all? Isn't it great to be together, to be able to praise and worship God and to not be so sweaty? That's even better. Just as if you haven't got a little communion cup, just pop your hand up and the girls and guys will bring those around to you. But communion, I love sharing communion because it's something we do together as a church family. And then when we stand before God, we stand side by side alone. He sees us as individual children, and that it's like you're the only person in the room. God has that ability to touch your heart and to let you know He sees you and He knows you and He hears the cries of your heart. And when we, it comes to communion, I'm just so reminded of God's forgiveness, being forgiven. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Isn't that a relief and a weight off your shoulders when you are given forgiveness, and when you receive it, and when you give it to somebody else and they actually receive it? What a weight is lifted off our shoulders. In Malachi 4 verse 6, the prophet Elijah is saying to the children of Israel, this is God's desire. My desire is to turn the hearts of the fathers back to their children and the hearts of the children back to their fathers. God sends a message to the prophet Elijah that He will turn the parents' hearts towards their children and the hearts of the children towards their parents. And for this to happen, there must be forgiveness. There must be both received and given. Yeah. Offense is what stops us from being reconciled. Yeah. And, you know, communication is a learnt skill. It's not something that you just automatically born with. Communication is a learnt skill. And there's, like I said, there's nothing worse than having pressure, tension between you and your spouse, between you and your children, between you and the people in your family and your circle, or the people you are working and living with. There's nothing worse, is there, than be having tension and to be ill at ease, and you know there's an issue, you know there's a problem. Sometimes you know exactly what the problem is, and other times you haven't got a clue, but you know you're in the doghouse, you're in the bad books. That you've done something and you should know what it is, but you got no clue. You know, there's tension and pressure, and it's horrible, isn't it? Yeah. Just recently, I have a beautiful family, but like every family, there comes times where there's tension, where expectations are not met, when things that were said long ago, and they you know, that you're trying to navigate in today's world, which is different from years ago. And it took about 2 months, and I prayed and I rang and I tried and I reached out, but I was just getting a bit stonewalled. And it was really, really awful. And then just recently, the phone call was received and the softness in the voice on the other end. What a relief. What a pressure lifted off me, and that prayers were answered, and forgiveness and reconciliation is given and received. Isn't that a beautiful thing? And I believe this morning that this is what God wants for you. And the Bible says that as far as it is possible with you, to live at peace with all people. You know, it's not always as possible with us to bring that peace. But as far as our side of things go, that we are releasing forgiveness, that we are the ones doing our best to be reconciled. Reconciliation happens. Someone has to, for it to happen, someone's got to start the process. Someone has to say, I'm sorry, I was wrong, I said the wrong thing, I did the wrong thing, please forgive me. There's that is the process that has to start. But the good news about this, about communion, God has already started that process with you and I and the entire human race, those born and those that have gone before, that he started this process to be reconciled with us. And he had a plan, and that was to send his son, Jesus, that he would take our place. We had a debt we had no hope of paying. We owed a lot because we had a lot. We had sin. We had things that were just, we needed someone to step in and take our place. And that's exactly what Jesus did. And every time we share this communion, we celebrate that fact that Jesus stepped in. He saw that we were hopeless, that there was no way we could pay this debt, and he paid it in full with his own body, with his own broken body and his shed blood. He gave us the right then to be called sons and daughters of God. We were reconciled to God through Christ. This was God's plan all along. And every time we share communion, we say, thank you, God, that you reconciled us. You didn't count our sins against us anymore. And the wrongs and the things that we had done, they had been reconciled to God through Christ. And then 2 Corinthians 5 verses 18 and 19, all this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and then gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us this message of reconciliation. Not only did he forgive us and restore us, but then he gives us the ability to help and to tell others that they can be reconciled, that they can have this weight lifted off them. This guilt, shame, it's not meant to be carried. It's not meant to be paid for in this life. Jesus paid for it in full. What? Just so beautiful. Just so beautiful. We need to take a moment around this communion to firstly ask God's forgiveness for us and to receive that. And then also to take a moment to think about people that you might have to apologize to be reconciled with, to be the first. That doesn't mean you let them off the hook. That's between them and God. Forgiveness sets you free. Doesn't get them off the hook. That's always up to God. That when we say, I forgive, I release forgiveness to you, you set yourself free. Because this, then if you do that, you won't get offended. Offense, the Bible says, it's like a bitter root, that like judgment. It springs up inside us and it defiles many. There's a really obscure verse in Jeremiah 31, 29, and this has been going around and around in my heart all week. And it says, no longer will they be able to say, our parents ate sour grapes, now, but the children's teeth have been set on edge. The parents ate sour grapes and the children's teeth have been set on edge. There was offense. There was something had happened, the previous generation, and the children picked up the offense and took it on and added some. And you can see that in history over and over and over again. And there's another part to this, that God gave that adult generation the chance to deal with their own issues and deal with their own faults and deal with their own sins. And their saying was, oh, it's our parents. They are the ones. They're the parents, the previous generation, they ate the sour grapes. And the children's teeth are set on edge. What can we do? What can we do? They just excused themselves of their responsibility to deal with their own stuff. And, you know, what the result of that was, that bitter root of judgment, it goes from one generation to the next to the next. And when you look at wars and civil wars in history, don't you see that happen over and over and over again? But God wants to break that cycle. And this is the chance to do that. Every time we share communion, we take ownership for our own stuff. We take ownership for as far as is possible with us, we live at peace. And we ask God's forgiveness. And we make, He's made the way, we receive it by faith. And just before we take communion together, there's another scripture to finish, Hebrews 12, 14 and 15 from the NIV. It says, make every effort to live at peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see God. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. So that's our responsibility. We're not going to blame, pass the blame, shift it anywhere. We take ownership and we make sure that no bitter root will grow up in us and cause trouble. Amen? Let's just take a moment to thank God that He made a way for us, that He wants us to be reconciled firstly to Himself and then to one another, that He has paid the price in full, and He has released to us His forgiveness that we can receive it freely. Why don't you take a moment, take out this bread, this little wafer that represents Christ's broken body that was given for us. On the night Jesus was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it. And He said, take this and eat it. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's do that together. Let's eat together. The same night He took a cup and He blessed it. And He said, take this cup and drink it. This is a cup that I make in my own blood, a new covenant. Let's drink together. Amen. Father God, we thank You for the power of forgiveness. And we take a moment right now. And every heart, as we each one of us examine our own heart, take responsibility for our own actions and reactions. We thank You, God, that You are merciful, You are good. Be the King of our hearts, Lord. Be the Lord of our hearts. That we will surrender this to You. I pray for every one of my brothers and sisters that You will help them to let go of what's hurt them, that they can release forgiveness and trust You with the outcome. I pray for reconciliation between families, between friends, between workmates and communities, Lord, that no root of judgment, bitter root of offense, will spring up and cause trouble and defile many. We come against that in Jesus' name. That Your peace, Your love, and the true spirit of reconciliation will come into our own hearts and minds and flow through us as we take that message with us everywhere we go. In Jesus' name, bless everyone of my brothers and sisters. Let them receive Your grace this morning. Amen. Amen. There's a lovely sense of God's love here. Just take that moment. Just take a moment.
Thank you, Laura. Thanks, Pastor Marilyn. Thank you, Lord, for Your grace. Thank You, Jesus. Awesome. Those cups will be
collected. The tent buckets will come past and you can put them in. And we're going to do something special now that we've never actually done before. And Tim and Ingrid are going to come up and just invite them to come on up and just share something with us. And we'll go from there. Let's welcome Tim and Ingrid. They do a great job. They're frontline teams and have faithfully served in our church for many, many years. Also are great teachers.
Pastors Russ and Mary Lynn, it's really an honor for us, Ingrid and I, to present you with long service trophies on behalf of our church. You've been with us for 20 plus years, and there are many others who've been here longer than we have, but I'm sure we all join together in thanking you for your long and your dedicated service here at Bayside. Your leadership, your wisdom, your passion has been a guiding light for all of us and inspiring us on our own journeys of faith, love, and service. Both your preaching, both of you, and your love for God's Word and for the Holy Spirit have challenged us, as well as your incredible faith and your passion, particularly for many to experience God and salvation as we see each week, and that's so inspiring, and we thank you for that.
Thank you.
We trust that God will continue to use you both in your ministry, and even another 20 years, hopefully. But, but however long God calls you, we believe that this is the place for you. And we believe that God's blessing and his favor rests upon you. And we, as the body of believers, receive that overflow of blessing and favor, just like on where the precious oil was poured down onto Aaron's head and it ran down his beard. So that is for us, referenced in Psalm 133. So, congratulations. 20 years is a long time of faithful service, and we really appreciate it. Thank you for all you do, and we love you, and congratulations. Thank you so much. That's really lovely. It's an absolute honor and a privilege to pastor here. It's coming. This is our 23rd year now, and we are just so incredibly grateful. And it never gets old. We just enjoy it. We love coming to church just as much as anybody. So we love you very much, and thank you for honoring us this way.
Thank you so, so much. And today wouldn't be complete without us honouring some other staff who have been here for a long time. And Pastor Peter and Emma, we'd like you guys to come. And let's give them a huge hand. Peter and Emma were here before we arrived. I remember the first week we were here, you were worship leading. How amazing that. And Peter was playing drums, I think, 22 and a half years ago. And so we've got some plaques for Peter's over 15 years. It's must be about 18, 19 years, but we couldn't give them the 20 years, so we've got a 15-year one for people. We're just doing the major milestone. And Emma's been over 10 years over in the office there, doing all of our accounts, making sure we get paid every week, keeping us out of jail by keeping us all the accounts and and insurance and all that sort of gear. So we'd like to present you these ones as well. So you got them? Yeah, thank you. If we can present those to Peter and Emma. Let's give them a huge thank you as well. Thank you so much. If you can stay up here. And we've got someone else who has done more than 10 years on staff, and that's Aaron Wasage. Come on down, Aaron. Wow. And Aaron's been worship leading, playing guitar, but he's been on staff for more than 10 years as our IT guy. He's kept us from keeping all our computers, our mobile phones, all our data projectors, and made sure we don't get scammed as a church. And Aaron, we want to thank you for faithfully serving us, and we honor you for faithfully serving in our church. You're a son of the house. God bless you. How awesome's that? We'll get a photo of everyone here. Yeah, Tennille needs an award for all the photos she took. She took 160 photos at the baptism a couple of weeks ago. And so we want to say, and you've got to take them out, hey? Mine as well. Okay. So thank you, church, and thank you for Tim. Tim's our church, acting church secretary, been on the board, and Ingrid, and we just thank you for that. And I think there's something powerful about celebrating and honouring. We don't do enough in Aussie culture, and we want to do more of that in honouring. We honour our volunteers, we honour our teams, and we want to say thank you for that privilege of worshipping and serving in this church, and to see how it's grown. There was about 50 or 60 people the first Sunday we came here, and look what God's done. Thanks, Pastor Peter. Over to you.
Thanks, Pastor Ross. Just a few things happening. Also, before I didn't have my notes on me, Carol Ballard also asked for prayer. She's unwell she's been unwell for about 10 days with a virus. So can we just keep Carol, many of you know Carol and Bevan, so just keep Carol in your prayers and pray that the healing for her. Also, today is David Clark's 60th birthday. Well done, mate. They're going to...
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday
to you. I'm sure you guys are going to have a celebration at lunch, I reckon, down there for sure. The cake will be everywhere. Got a few. We love to celebrate with transformations, and just got a few awards to give out. Michelle Burgess has finished stage one. Come on down, Michelle. How you doing? There you go. They'll probably want to get a photo. Just stay up here for 2 seconds. Also, resident of the month, Alison Moreau. And also Tyler Emmett, resident of the month. Come up, Tyler. There you go, mate. Awesome. Well done, guys. We're cheering you on. Awesome. Cool. It's good to celebrate. Today we're celebrating a whole lot of stuff. It's all happening. Anyone else want to celebrate anything else? Anyone got a wedding anniversary, birthdays? Oh, you're over here, wedding anniversary. Tomorrow, how many years? 29. Awesome. Well done. I won't start asking everyone else because we'll be here all day. But congratulations. just want to come around our time of giving as we get ready to give today. I just want to share a story. This is a story that Nikki Gumbel shared about a guy he met. And it goes like this. He was brought up on the roughest estates in Manchester. His father was an alcoholic. This is not Nikki. This is this guy. He left school at 15. He ran away from home. He lived on the streets. He joined a gang. He got involved in crime and ended up in prison. When he came out, he joined the army. He went through two divorces, and in 1994, he walked into their church, which is Nikki's church in the UK, and he did Alpha, which we're nearly come to the end to, and we do in our church as well. He encountered Jesus and was filled with the Holy Spirit. He started visiting prisoners. He joined the staff team to head up the work in prisons. He started an organization to care for ex-offenders. He set up a homeless project. He started a course to help those with addictions and courses to help those struggling with depression and debt. Under his leadership, Alpha for Prisons has spread through the prisons in the UK and 76 countries around the world. Thousands have come to faith in Jesus Christ. Hundreds of men and women have been placed in churches through the ministry of caring for ex-offenders. Paul Cowley is his name, author of Thief, Prisoner, Soldier, Priest, is an example of someone who was the good soil, or which the seed fell into good soil in his life. He has a noble and good heart. He heard the word, retained it, and by persevering has produced a crop hundreds of times more than what was sown. He encountered Jesus as his Savior, Sower, and Shepherd. And just want to read that verse in Luke 8:15 in the Amplified. It says, "But as for that seed in the good soil, these are the ones who have heard the word with a good and noble heart, and hold on to it tightly and bear fruit with patience." And I read that last word, bear fruit with patience. Do you know that when we sow, it isn't instant? That a farmer doesn't sow seed and walk out the next day and go, "Where is it? Like, what are you doing, crop?" You know, like, or start digging up the ground looking for potatoes or whatever, and destroying them, or whatever it is. And it's like that, and it's exactly the same with our finances. Something we give and we sow. Kingdom giving is sowing into the kingdom. And sometimes there is fruit, you see it quickly, but often you just keep sowing and sowing and sowing, and in the background God is bringing an increase, and suddenly it builds, and suddenly there is much fruit. There's an abundant harvest. There's many people saved. There's buildings built, and there's lives transformed, and sometimes God just it's like growing in the ground, and all of a sudden it just shoots up and you see it. And so my encouragement is that when God can take a life like his, that you would have written him off. It's like, reminds me of some of you guys or girls, that you probably maybe have a story that was a bit like his possibly, and maybe you got written off, but then he met Jesus and everything changed. And God changed not just him, but changed thousands of lives simply because he met Jesus. And so I encourage you, church, keep sowing. Keep giving financially. Keep sowing and serving. Keep helping others. Sowing into good soil. Hearing the word. Because our giving is an extension of the word of God. Yeah. And when we sow it, it brings a great harvest. If we have patience and don't give up and just keep faithfully sowing. So I encourage you to give today. Many people give electronically, and many also give cash. So the buckets will come around in a moment. And God honors your life, and he honors his word when we give. And so I'm just going to pray today. And there may be people here in financial need or need work or whatever that may be. And I'm going to pray for that as well. If that's you, you can agree with me in prayer. So Lord, we just thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. I thank you for his story, Lord God, that you changed that life and are still changing lives to this day because of what you did in John's life. I pray, Father God, that for people here, Lord, have faithfully sown for many, many years, for many tens, from decades, for some people have been a part of this church, that have sown faithfully with their time and their heart, Lord God, and practically, but also financially, Lord God, and you see it all. And I thank you, Lord, we are patient. Lord God, you we see see an increase, Lord. We see an abundance, Lord God. We see it happen, Lord God. And Lord, I thank you that you're at work, Lord God, in everything we're doing. And Lord, I pray, Father, for people today that are needing work, Lord God, or needing employees in their business, Lord God, or they are in need of financial need, or they need a breakthrough in some way. I pray, Lord God, that you would just, Lord, bless them today. Lord, I pray, Lord, for that increase. I pray for that breakthrough. I pray that you would meet every need. Those that need permanent accommodation, Lord God. Those that have needs of practical needs. I pray, Lord God, that you would be at work as they faithfully, they are here saying, God, I need your help in this area. I pray that you would move right now on their behalf. Thank you, Lord. And I pray as we sow, Lord God, we want to see a harvest of hundreds and thousands of people, Lord God, in our city, in our nation, Lord God, that come to you because we have faithfully sowed financially and faithfully sowed with our hearts of servant and practically, Lord God, and helping our neighbor. I pray, Lord God, we'd see people get saved, Lord, every week. And I pray, Lord, for an increase in abundance, Lord God. We thank you for it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Bless your church with your giving. And we'll just, can we go to that? Have we got that disciple promo? Yep, awesome. Let's go to the screen and watch that.
Across our nation, we've seen a need to develop resilience and stronger foundations. So we're very excited to announce Disciple, a course designed for local churches. Whether you are an individual wanting to grow or a pastor wanting to build stronger foundations into your people, this course will be an invaluable resource. Each session includes 3 10-minute videos from incredible pastors across our nation, as well as specialists from the team at Alpha Crucis University College. There will be discussion questions and resources to further equip your people. Here's some really good news. This course is affordable, easily accessible, and scalable for your church. So whether it's used in small groups, for discipleship course, or with your leadership team, this course is going to be a resource for you and your church.
Awesome. So that's going to be a great course. The church has purchased that, and it's free. So just make sure that's clear. So and it's free to come, and we've got a whole lot of people signing up for that. It's starting on the 5th of May, and it's going to run on Sunday afternoon for 13 weeks. And I've looked at the material. It's going to be a great course. And the whole reason we're running is because we want people to be discipled. We want people to grow. We want people to not just come to church and I said, oh, I'm saved, but they want to grow. We want people to be growing, have a strong foundation. So no matter what comes along, you will be strong and steadfast and nothing will shake you. And so that's the whole idea. So maybe you've been a Christian a long time, but you're saying, oh, I haven't really sort of, you know, have been discipled well. I've sort of come to church. You're welcome to come. It's not just for new Christians. People of all ages are doing it. We delayed the start of it a little bit just so, because as people are doing Alpha, it's wrapping up, want to do Disciple and flow straight into that. So it's going to be a great course. So I encourage you, please sign up outside. You can do that. And it's starting in 3 or 4 weeks' time, but it's going to be a great course. Also, something else that's starting up is a youth espresso bar on the 28th of April, starting before church. So you'll be able to buy yourself a real coffee and someone in our church has given us a nice coffee machine and really blessed the church. And so where the youth are going to use that to raise money for their youth camp and different things they're doing. So you can come early, be open half an hour before the service and also open at morning tea. Still be able to get free tea and coffee out the back, but this coffee will just be a little bit better. That's why you got to pay for it. And but it's all going to be happening. And, you know, as it goes, it's all going to be good. But and also you're supporting the youth at the same time. So I encourage that's happening and available to anyone who'd like to be involved with that. Grab yourself a coffee. Also, on the 28th of April, the Youth Advance, they're doing a car wash for their youth camp. So if you want to get your car washed, it's basically a donation basis. So starting at $100 to $1,000. No. So, but whatever. Yeah, Matt's happy with that amount. But no, it's whatever you can afford. And depending on the job they do, you know, you kind of, but no, I encourage you to get your car washed, plan that day. So on the 28th of April, And it's going to help them get our young people to camp this year, which is going to be awesome. So plenty of good things happening. And get involved. If you're not involved with the Connect group or anything like that, info for that's outside. We just want, there's many things happening through the week at church you can get involved with. And we love for you to be a part of it and be connected into Bayside. Why don't you stand to your feet? And let's welcome Pastor Ross as he comes to share the word today.
Thank you, thank you. It's so good to be in church. Isn't it great? It's a big family. Before I preach, I want to honor Ashley Muller. He was playing keyboards the day we came 23 and a half years ago. Mary Lynn sang and he accompanied it. Well, let's give him a big shout out for Ashley, faithfully serving. And he was here before we came. And Ashley, I just felt the Lord say he's going to renew your joy in worshiping and music. You've done it faithfully for so long, but I just saw a new burst of joy and passion and enthusiasm for just loving Jesus and worshiping and being a blessing to many people through the gift that you know is from God. And he's going to keep growing it. You think, hey, I've just achieved so much already, but I believe God's going to grow it even more. And there's a new joy just going to come. And we want to honor you, Ashley, for just loving and serving Jesus with all of your heart, eh? I don't think you had a beard when we first came. You had more head up here and now it's slipped down here, but that's okay. Bless your light. One other thing, as we were being honored before, I felt the Lord just nudge my heart. There's some of you here, you feel you haven't been honored in life very much at all. You've done stuff. You've helped people, you've raised kids, or you've worked hard, and it's like, how come everyone else seems to get the honor and I miss out? Two things I felt the Lord say. Number one, the Heavenly Father sees you and honors you today. He wants you to receive that. Whether people have acknowledged or not, today he wants you to know that he is honoring you. And secondly, there's a powerful principle, we reap what we sow. So whether you feel honored or not, just start honoring others and see what God will do. Instead of thinking, I've missed out, so how can I bless someone else who might be thinking they've missed out in honor or encouragement? And let's sow that. And in time, God's got ways of just blessing our lives. Father, I just thank you. If that's you today, just reach up and say, Lord, I just received that. Lord, I just pray blessing on some that feel like they've been missed out or even dishonored. Today, I cut that off in Jesus' name and I release honor and a Father's blessing. I really release blessing over people today that they would feel blessed, honored, accepted, and Lord, that this church will be a community that honors one another, that honors you and lives under the favor and honor of God. I pray that now in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Let's take our seats. Wow, what a great day in the house of God to celebrate together. And a few weeks ago, I started a series on Jesus' way of discipleship. And I've started a few, and we looked at some of the things that Jesus did when he discipled his believers and still does today. Number one, Jesus was full of grace and truth. Number two, Jesus was full of light, that his light dispels the darkness. And I love that in John 1:5, it says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Thirdly, Jesus was a man of prayer. We see he prayed all night before he picked his disciples. He often got up early and prayed. And the disciples said, teach us to pray. And that's where we have the Lord's Prayer. Number four, Jesus was full of the power of the Holy Spirit. It says he was led by the Spirit in the wilderness. He overcome the temptation. Then it said he came out in the power of the Holy Spirit. Fifthly, Jesus moved in great power and authority, and they thought, where do you get this authority from? Because the Father's blessing was over his life. And then last week we started to pick up on the sixth point, Jesus revealed Father God. And I just want to pick up that a bit more today and then move on to another point as well. But John 1:18 says, no one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. And last week I was going through the book of John And I found 99 times in the Gospel of John alone, it refers to Jesus revealing the Heavenly Father. So that's a challenge for some of you that love to check out with the pastors telling the truth. Read the Gospel of John and count them all up. If you find more, I'll celebrate with you. But I know there's at least 99 times. Here's a couple of them. John 13, 1, it says, it was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go back to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening was in meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Listen to verse 3. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So Jesus had a sense of purpose and identity with his Heavenly Father, and that enabled him to speak with power, to heal the sick, set captives free, and it also enabled him to put aside his crown and pick up the towel and wash his disciples' feet. When you are secure in who you are and in your relationship with the Heavenly Father, you can do whatever God asks you to do in life and not feel ashamed, not feel condemned, don't have to compare with others because you have this sense of peace that I'm doing what God's gifted me and called me to do. And so Jesus could lay aside his kingly authority and pick up a towel and wash the disciples' feet. And that was the role of a servant when you came through the door. But because Jesus was there, everyone got so excited they forgot to do the normal custom of washing one another's feet. Because they walked with open sandals on dusty roads. There were camels and donkeys and cattle and all sorts of stuff on dusty roads. They weren't nice paved paths and bitumen streets. Their feet were really dirty when they got to someone's house. So the first thing that was done, they greeted them and then they washed their feet as they took their sandals off. Jesus, because he knew who he was with the Father, was able to take the towel and wash his feet. John 5 verse 18 says, for this reason they tried all the more to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he's even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Jesus gave them this answer. Very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. When he went and prayed, I believe he had relationship with his Father, and the Father would show him what was going to happen that day. So when a funeral comes past, he had already in prayer seen by faith that he was going to raise that child from the dead. And so he walked in such a relationship with the Heavenly Father that God showed him ahead of time what was going to happen. And he mightn't have got all the details, but he would have been prepared for whatever came along his path. And we can walk with the Holy Spirit and a relationship with God that he often prepares us when something bad news is coming. Often you just get a bit of a warning, you're ready. You know, you've got extra strength, or you've got a scripture. Or there's an opportunity coming and there's a divine excitement when you get up and think, hey, something good's going to happen today. You don't know what it is, but you're ready for it when it comes. And I believe God can prepare us to face life with a sense of anticipation and excitement, not fear and dread and anxiety, because he fills us with his presence. It goes on and it says, for the Father loves the Son, verse 20, and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honour the Son just as they honour the Father. Whoever does not honour the Son does not honour the Father who sent him. There's a powerful truth in there, that at the end of time, Jesus is going to be our judge, not the Heavenly Father. And Jesus come to reveal the Father, and it says he walked on this earth and was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. It says we can come to the throne of grace and mercy to find help in our time of need, because Jesus was tempted in all points like we are. Hey, that gives us hope, hey? It's not a distant, absent, judgmental Father that's going to judge it. It's Jesus, the Son, that the Father has given all judgment to for our now and eternity. That is so life-giving that Jesus is our Son. Let's go on to John 14, verse 6. We finished on this verse last time. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And that reminds us that that's the whole gospel, not just the way, the truth, and life. That the reason he accepts us and forgives us is so that we can come into relationship with our Heavenly Father. Then it goes on and said, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you such a long time, he's been walking with them for 3.5 years, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it's the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. I love that. So even if you're struggling, where does God fit in? And where's the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? He says, hey, if you can't get your head around it all yet, just see the fruit and the works that are coming out of believers' lives. That's really good news. Then it goes on and says, very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I'm going to the Father. Because the Father lived in him, he revealed the Heavenly Father, his grace, mercy, forgiveness. He said, I'm going back to the Father, and I'm going to release his presence and authority, and you're going to do even greater things than I do. And as a new believer, I thought, greater than Jesus? How can we do that? Well, it can happen in all sorts of ways. Number one, he was one person, and so now we're believers all over the world, so we're doing a lot greater because there's all of us all over the world. Greater works is because Jesus never sinned. We have, then we're forgiven, and then out of that brokenness and out of that healing, we can reach other broken people. So we do a different, greater work than Jesus did because he never sinned. But we have, we're restored so we can reach broken people with a grace and a mercy and an understanding that Jesus never experienced fully in that light. How amazing is that? That's a different, greater work. There are so many ways that you can see and interpret that scripture that we can reach out. A greater work is when Mary Lynn was talking about being offended and then being forgiven and then showing forgiveness to others. That's a greater work. That's very powerful. It's a difficult one to do when you've been hurt and wounded, because you want to get revenge and even, but when you let the grace of God heal your heart, you then can forgive and release that to other people. What an amazing gift. That's a gift we can give to one another. And it goes on, and it says, verse 13, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Wow. If you struggle with why I should pray, there's a really good reason. Ask the Father for bold things. Some people say, I don't get many answers to prayers. Sometimes because we just don't pray big enough and bold enough prayers. He's waiting to answer them because we step out and believe that all things are possible to him that believes. Jesus paid for our sin on the cross. He paid for our sickness. He paid for restoration from every scheme of the enemy. Every curse is broken. So therefore, when we pray and believe, we can see that come out to other people's lives. God says, come on, lift your prayer. Let your faith rise. Take authority. Come on, ask boldly and believe for your whole neighborhood to come to Christ. And some of us have just got to step up and believe in greater ways. God, you can use me. You can flow through me. God, you can use my business. You can use my education. You can use my broken experience into a place of a testimony that brings hope to other people. God says, come on, I've done it. Let it flow through your life. Greater things. Greater things. You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. Why? Because the verse before says, I will do whatever you ask in mine so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. So whenever you ask for things and you step out and believe for them, you pray for the sick, you share hope, you offer forgiveness, you offer hope, encouragement to people, you are honoring the Father for what he has done through Jesus. So it's not just about you being acknowledged and saying, hey, you're a good person, you're a generous person, you're a charitable person. Those words might come from humanity because they don't know any other way to say it, but Jesus says the Father's honored and Jesus is honored through your life because you're carrying the same thing that he carried, because Christ is in us, the hope of glory in our hearts, and the Father gets glorified. Why on earth does the devil make sure that people swear and curse the name of Jesus? They don't curse other gods. They curse the name of Jesus because the devil fights to dishonor Jesus and to dishonor God. Even the insurance company said an act of God when a terrible thing's happened. Where did that come from? It says every good and perfect gift comes from the Father up above. So all of society tries to dishonor the Father and dishonor Jesus. And so as believers, we've got the opportunity to push back against that and reveal the kingdom of God and his grace and mercy and goodness and kindness upon our society, upon humanity. That's what Jesus does when we let him flow through our lives and the Father is exalted. So many people have a father wound in their soul. People are driven to seek a father's approval, an authority figure's approval and acceptance. And they want to get sometimes from an earthly father that only they can receive from a heavenly father. There are some things on this earth that are never going to quite measure up. And Luke 11 talks about if a child asks a father for some food, is he going to give him a snake or a scorpion or a stone? He says, just as your earthly fathers try to do a good thing and fall short, how much more will your heavenly Father send the Holy Spirit to those who ask? How much more will the heavenly Father do good? And I love that song we're singing, you are good, you are good. Some of you need to echo that this week. You are good. Because the devil tries to get you to believe that God's been unfair and missed you out and ignored you and let things happen to you that were just not fair. Come on, our God's a good God. And we need to change our belief and our expectation that he's a good, good Father. That's who you are. I believe it. I declare it. I live under the blessing and favor of it. You're a good, good Father. Lord, you've blessed us abundantly. And some of us need to change our confession and our belief and our expectation. Because if you believe that someone's going to be hard and cruel, guess what? That's how it'll come to you. But if you believe he's a good father that's going to forgive and strengthen and restore and give you hope no matter what's going on, guess what? You'll start to walk in and live in that reality. That's what faith is called. Believing that he's a good, good father. Draw close to Jesus and he will reveal the heavenly Father to you. If you've had a poor or a distant or an absent or abusive, natural, earthly father figure, let me tell you, when you draw close to Jesus, he'll start to reveal the true heavenly Father. There'll be sometimes a transference for a season because that's all you've known and it's been imprinted on your soul as a child or a young person. But let me tell you, when Jesus fills our life, he starts to stamp his identity over our soul. And his stamp over our mind and soul is much stronger, much more powerful than any stamp of the enemy over our minds and our hearts. And I was sharing at the baptism class with the transformation guys a few weeks ago how that Pastor David Pawson from England, I heard him speak personally in Nambour in the early 1980s, a lovely, godly Baptist preacher and pastor. Some of you have heard his teaching. And he told the story that years ago, all these people were getting baptized. And they were having a real move of God in the late 70s at the end of the charismatic move. And some of them were coming out of really broken. A lot of them were bikies and rough people, and they had tattoos all over them. And that was all fine. They were getting saved. But one guy just held out. All his mates are getting baptized. He would always pull back. And one day the pastor said, "Why don't you get baptized?" And he says, "Look, I'm really so ashamed." He said, "When I was living a rough life, I got a tattoo of Satan put over my heart to say I belong to the devil. Big tattoo over his chest." He said, "When I get baptized and got my white shirt on and they might see that tattoo, and I'm just so ashamed that I just can't do it." The pastor's been telling him, his mates are telling him, "Look, it's all about the heart. It's not what tattoos or what scars or what you've got on your body. Jesus took the greatest scars on the cross, and his name and his blood cleanses us." Eventually this guy thought, "Oh, look, I'm just going to do it anyway." And as he went down the water and came up out of the water, he had tattoos all over his body because that's just the life he'd lived. But miraculously, the tattoo of Satan over his heart was totally washed away, and he had totally clean skin on that one. True story. The pastor told me, he said, "I was there and saw it happen." The other tattoos weren't washed away, but that one was, because it held such a spiritual significance. And the shame, the guilt, and the fear. Can you imagine his testimony after that, mate? He would have been so bold, he would have gone anywhere and everywhere and preached the gospel. I think the enemy has stamped things on our lives through pain and neglect and rejection and abuse, control, all sorts of stuff. But let me tell you, when Jesus starts to stamp his nature and identity on us, it is way stronger than any other stamp. And the Father's love wraps around our hearts, and it'll stop you striving to try and find who you are. It'll give you identity and identity. It'll stop you striving to try and prove yourself to someone. There's a peace. There's a wholeness. There's a love. There's an identity of Father God revealed to us through Jesus Christ. That's why this is so powerful. Maybe a young person, you think, "Hey, I just wish I was born in another family. Just wish I was born in that family down the road that seemed to have a peaceful life, but ours was chaos." Well, sometimes we have people that are born in well-to-do households, but pride and entitlement comes, and that locks them off from just being approachable and real. But Jesus has come to reveal the Father's heart, and his nature will be revealed to your life. So when Jesus discipled people, he revealed the Father's love to their lives. That's why Peter, when he denied the Lord, it says he wept bitterly and he ran out and he was so ashamed. And you notice on the day that Jesus rose from the dead, he met Mary Magdalene and some of the women. And he says, "Go and tell the disciples and Peter that I've risen." Because he would have known how ashamed Peter was. He felt like he'd blown it forever. He was the first one, when Jesus said, "Who do you think I am?" He said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And he says, "That hasn't been revealed to you by natural people. That's from the Spirit of God." And now, he was the first one to get the revelation of Jesus. Now he's the first one to deny him totally. And then a couple of weeks later, Jesus meets them out on the beach. They're out fishing. He's got the fire going. And as they come in, they realize it's Jesus. He says, "Come and have some breakfast." It's interesting to note, Jesus already had his fish and he was cooking the fish before they brought their fish in. He said, "Bring yours as well." Jesus will always let us bring who we are to him, and then he changes it. And when Peter got near the fire, the last time he was near Jesus was at the fire on the night before Jesus was betrayed, and the smoke and the coals and the flames. And when he came off the boat, walked up the beach, what did he smell? The same smells that he felt a couple of weeks before when he denied Jesus. They, Doctors say that one of the strongest senses we have is the sense of smell. That smell will sometimes take us back to an event or a place quicker than any other of our five senses. And then Jesus has the interaction with Peter. Do you love me? Yeah, Jesus, you know I love you. Three times he asked him. Three times he denied him. And in the end he says, go and feed my sheep. Jesus restored Peter to the Father's plan for his life. Because he faced his shame, didn't deny it, didn't judge him, say, Peter, why did you leave me? Why did you not? He didn't do any of that. God doesn't come with judgment, he comes with mercy to lift us, forgive us, and put us back on the path if we've ever blown it. There's some people here today who think, hey, I had so many opportunities and a call of God in my life, but I missed it or I blew it or I just... I feel the Spirit of God today calling some of you back to your original purpose in life. The call of God on your life, that call to do missions trips, that call to care for broken, needy people. You say, oh, it's just too hard and I've been ripped off so many times, I've been taken advantage of. God's going to touch your heart and give you a Father's love that's going to override all the things that have stolen your identity and purpose. Don't settle where you are. Don't be stuck between the two fires like Peter was for a couple of weeks. The fire of betrayal and denial and the fire of restoration, where he had to face his shame and his fear and his guilt. Way too many people are caught between the two fires in their life for years or decades, and they live angry, frustrated, broken lives when Jesus says, come. Come and be restored. I feel God's compassion drawing people back to your purpose in life. Don't let religion, other people's opinions, the lies of the devil, or your own shame and fear hold you back from what God has called you to be and do. Don't get stuck between the two fires and live a life that's not fulfilling what God's called you to be. We'll just look at one more today before we wrap it up. And when Jesus called his disciples, he gave them the Holy Spirit. Listen to this. John 20 verse 19 says, on the evening of that first day of the week, this is after he rose from the dead, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them. He just walked through the wall. I'm here. If that wasn't enough to freak him out. And he says, peace be with you. In other words, don't freak out. I've now got my resurrected body that is not limited by the things of this earth. So he could just walk through walls. He came, and this is what he said. After he said this, he showed him his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. They're probably still a bit terrified. Put yourself in the situation. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. He breathed on them, receive the Holy Spirit. Now, this was before the day of Pentecost. Jesus, before he went to heaven, breathed on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Spirit that I ministered in on this earth, and you guys were trying to understand how I did it. Receive the Helper, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, so you can do what I've called you to do. Then it goes on in John 15, 26. When the Helper, the Comforter, the Advocate, the Intercessor, the Counselor, the Strength, and the Standby, that's the seven words that describe who the Holy Spirit is, whom I will send to you, Jesus said, I will send to you from the Father, that is the Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father, he will testify and bear witness about me. Jesus is preparing them, saying, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. He breathed on them that night. Now we go to Acts chapter 1, verse 4. And while being in their company and eating with them, this is Jesus before he went back to heaven, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, of which he said, you have heard me speak. He's referring back to John 15. He's referring back to the night he breathed on them about the Holy Spirit. For John baptized with water, but not many days from now you shall be baptized with, placed in, introduced into the Holy Spirit. So when they were assembled, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will reestablish the kingdom and restore it to Israel? He said to them, it's not for you to become acquainted with and know what time brings, the things and events of time and their definite periods, or fixed years and seasons, their critical niche in time, which the Father has appointed, fixed and reserved by his own choice and authority and personal power. I think there's a really interesting word that Jesus spoke there. Don't be too worried about when I'm going to come back. It's going to happen. There are signs, and way too many Christians get so distracted they forget to listen to this warning of Jesus. Don't get so distracted trying to work out when I'm coming. Just get busy doing what I've told you to do, and I'll show up at the right time. And that's one of the last things Jesus said to his disciples. I've met Christians and they're so consumed about all the end time events and all the charts and all the times, and they've got dozens of books on it. It's okay to be curious. It's okay to study the word, but don't be distracted by that from what God's called us to be and do. His light, his love, his witness into the kingdom of this world, and he will show up when it's right time, when the Father says, okay, come back now. It's going to happen. I'm excited. It says, look forward to it. But I do not waste a whole lot of time trying to work out when it's going to be, when Jesus specifically told us and warned us, don't waste your time doing that. Wow. I've just made a few enemies and a few friends. That's okay, because this is what Jesus said. It's not my words. It's what Jesus said. Because he knew humanity would spend the rest of the days trying to work out when it was going to happen. It's okay. It's going to happen. Expect it. Look forward to it. But don't get distracted by a whole lot of conspiracy theories and stuff. Just be busy doing what I've called you to do. And then it says, but you shall receive power, ability, efficiency and might when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth, the very bounds of the earth. He says, wait until the power of God comes. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty and freedom. Then this, they 10 days later, Jesus then went to heaven. They waited for 10 days, prayed. At least 500 of them waited. There was 120 left after 10 days. Wouldn't it really suck if you were one of the 380 that gave up waiting? It would be terrible if you left at 20 to 9 on the morning when the Holy Spirit was poured out. I'm hungry. I'm out of here. Wouldn't that be terrible? But 120 stayed. Waited until the Holy Spirit got poured out because they didn't know what it was going to look like. Acts 2, 1 says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Wow, wow, wow. This is what Jesus said. Don't leave Jerusalem until you're filled with the Spirit. Today, the Spirit of God's saying, don't leave church without being filled with the Spirit. Don't try and do Christian life without the power of the Holy Spirit. Don't try and do it out of tradition and religion and the things that you've learned in the past. Don't try and do it just by claiming a promise from God without the Holy Spirit empowering it. It says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. That word is a rhema word, which is an inspired word by the Holy Spirit. And that's what releases faith in your life. Otherwise, faith is a head trip instead of a heart revelation. Whoa, God. Religion is full of head trips and man's attempt to understand God, which is not wrong. But if you stay there, you're going to miss out on the revelation by the Holy Spirit of who the kingdom of God is and who Jesus is and who the Father is and what his plan and purpose for our life and what the church is called to be and do. Instead of a religious organization, it's a living organism that's bringing kingdom life to our broken world. But it only comes as the Holy Spirit fills our hearts. Let's stand in his presence. Worship team, come, because we just want to take a couple of minutes before we finish today so that we do what Jesus told us to do, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. be filled with the Holy Spirit. I want you just for the next 5 minutes before we finish today to say, God, I want that fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. Maybe you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit and spoken in other tongues. Maybe you haven't had that stirring in your heart when you read the Bible. It comes alive to you. Think, hey, I know about it. But it's a religious understanding. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, I speak in that heavenly language. It says it builds up our most holy faith. When I pray in that heavenly language, it releases kingdom revelation over my life. There's been so many battles throughout church history over speaking in tongues, over the Holy Spirit baptism power. What is it? What isn't it not? Because the enemy knows there's a power released when we do what Jesus said. Wait until you're filled and then go and do what I've called you to do. And I just want to take a few minutes today as we just worship Him. Let the Holy Spirit come. Let's reach our hands up to heaven right now for a moment. Let's thank Him that He sent the Father sent the Son to reveal the kingdom of God to us, to reveal the Father, to reveal the Holy Spirit. He breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. He breathed on them, receive the Holy Spirit in His fullness and power. Not just a religious understanding as part of the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. No, this is a revelation. This is life-giving breath into your soul. Come on, reach up to heaven right now. Let His Spirit come. Oh, thank Him for a moment. Jesus, thank You for sending the Holy Spirit. Thank You for sending Your life. Thank You for forgiving me and cleansing me. Oh, Jesus, if you feel with that, if you have a heavenly language, just pray in that spirit for a moment. Just pray in the heavenly language. Let it flow, because it's a gift of God. It's something to worship and give praise to God for. If you've never spoken a heavenly language, it's a heavenly gift for your life right now. Come on, God's going to fill people right now with His Spirit and power. Don't be afraid. The Spirit of God's here, just touching our hearts right now. There's life, there's love, there's hope. Oh, there's freedom right now in the Spirit. Oh, there's love overflowing our hearts. Oh, let Your love flow. Oh, Jesus, just fill our hearts. We glorify You, Jesus. We lift You up on high. We lift You up on high, Jesus. You are worthy. You are worthy of all of our praise. Oh, we give You praise, Lord. Oh, You are so good, Lord. Oh, Your love just lifting people right now, setting people free in Jesus' name. God, set our hearts free right now, Lord, from fear and from religion, from shame and guilt. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Right now as you worship, some people are feeling the healing power of God. There's someone with arthritis down their right hip. Right now, the healing power of Jesus coming. Someone's been afraid of the Spirit because of what you were taught in another church. The Spirit of God's lifting that off you now and saying, come on, just receive that freedom of God over your heart. Oh, we love You. We love You, Lord. Oh, Jesus, we're hungry for You and Your ways. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Lord. We love You, Jesus. The Father's love is just reaching out to people right now. Maybe you're here today and you've never really opened your heart to Jesus. And boy, this is pretty full on. But there's something in your spirit saying, God's here. There's a life, there's an energy, there's a love of God that I've never fully experienced before. I want to ask the question, do you know this amazing Jesus? Have you ever opened your heart to Him? Or maybe you have someone in the past, but it's time to come back to Him today. You can feel love and energy and hope. And Jesus is offering forgiveness for your life. If that's you today saying, Pastor Ross, I want to come to Jesus. I want to come back to Him today. If that's you, just lift your hand and give me a wave today because I feel the Spirit of God tugging at hearts right now. Who's that today? God's calling you. You've never done this or it's time to come back. Who's that today? The Spirit of God's tugging at you. God bless you down there. Who else today saying, that's me. That's me. I need to come, Jesus, or come back. Who else today? God's calling. I can feel His love tugging at your heart right now. God bless you. Who else today saying, that's me. That's me. God's calling you. He loves you so much. Oh, He's calling you to Himself. Oh, we love you, Jesus. God bless you. Let's sing this beautiful song. Just one through. And if you've put your hand up, I'd like to pray for you today. Just come and join us down the front here because I feel the Spirit of God's tugging at your heart. Come with a friend. If that's you, come. Just come. Come and join us because the Spirit of God's here. I want to pray with you right now. Come. Oh. you are. That's right. Just come. God bless you. God bless you. Come on. Come. Oh, Jesus. You are. God bless you. Come and join us. Jesus, some of the team come and stand with them right now. The Spirit of God's just touching hearts. The presence of God is just setting people free right now. This is the most powerful miracle, is to people to come to Jesus or come back to Him. God bless you. Bible says that Jesus came to forgive us our sin, to restore our hearts. This is so powerful. He loves you so much. What you're feeling today is hope and forgiveness. Eyes of shame or guilt, you're now into a place of forgiveness and hope. God loves you, bro. He really cares for you. Your head's trying to work it all out, but your heart knows something's happening today. I'm going to lead you in a prayer today. Congregation, why don't we pray this prayer together? Bible says if we confess with our mouth Jesus Lord and believe in our heart, you will be saved. Let's close our eyes and let's declare this together. Maybe you're watching online today. Right now, Jesus is calling you. Why don't you pray this prayer and open your heart to Jesus? Let's pray. Father God, thank you for sending Jesus to be my Savior. Forgive me. Heal me. Set me free. I choose to follow you with all of my heart. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Fill me with your Holy Spirit.
Fill me with your Holy
in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Just reach out towards these right now. Father, just touch them with your healing power. Lord, touch them with your saving power in Jesus' name. Touch Mark with your grace and power in Jesus' name. It's a new day.
We'd love for you to get in touch with us. You can connect with us by checking out the link in the below description for our social links and contacts. We hope you encounter God's love, connect with the Word, and feel that you belong in the Bayside family. God bless you.